Hi, I'm Will Diaz, and welcome to The Real Deal, a show devoted to filmmaking. We'll talk to the people behind the scenes and in front of the camera who come together to bring their visions to life. Jimmy Wilden, up next on The Real Deal. In the studio today, we have Jimmy Wilden. He's an award-winning writer and filmmaker from Corpus Christi, Texas. He is also a musician and composer. Welcome to The Real Deal. Thanks for coming in today.
Thanks for having me.
From my understanding, your artistic roots grow from a love of writing. Can you tell me the first time you realized that writing meant more to you than it would to the average person?
I guess that would have been in third grade. I had started writing little short stories back in like first grade, and but come third grade, I written this short story, and I was really excited about it. Showed it to my teacher, and she got really excited about it, and so she had me start reading them in front of the class. And so I wrote a sequel to it, and then I wrote another sequel to it, and I got the automatic feedback from the class, and all of them laughed, and it was fun to experience. And then she asked if I wanted some more guidance with writing, and so in third grade she set me up with a fifth grade tutor, or an assistant teacher, who would look over my writing and talk to me about it, and we just chatted about writing, and that sent me in the direction of really falling in love with it.
When was the first time you put together a script, a movie style script?
Well, I had started writing scripts in middle school. They weren't anywhere near being an actual screenplay, but it was my own version of it. It was like a play meets a novel. And then it was in about 1999, when American Beauty came out, I read that script, and immediately I wanted to write my own version of it, and so I started writing my very first screenplay.
When it comes to the finished film, how well does your script writing translate to the finished product?
Pretty well. I am open-minded. I know that filmmaking is a collaborative effort, so I like to talk with the actors and get their point of view on things. But it depends on the genre for me. If it's more of a comedy, it's really open, and a lot of times it evolves. But dramas and different things like that, I stay pretty true to what I wrote on the page.
In your film, The In-Between Place, which we're going to see in shortly, mm-hmm. I couldn't help but feel that the music propelled the story forward. Mm-hmm. Did you use that device? Was that a conscious decision?
That was a conscious decision. When I set out to write that one, I really wanted to focus on putting the music in the forefront. In previous little films I've made, I sometimes went without music completely. But this one, I really wanted to use that as a device to propel the movie along and see where we can take it.
Did you have the music written before you had the script?
Mm-mm.
What about when it comes to music or film, what's more important to you? Is it music or is it film?
I have a love for both. Growing up, my dad always like, you might need to choose. Which one would you choose? And I said, I don't think I could ever choose. I find there's certain points in my life where I gravitate towards music, and then certain points in my life where I'm all about filmmaking. So, and then when the two come together, that's the perfect world.
In this film, The In-Between Place, can you talk about some which we're gonna watch? Can you tell us a little bit about it, kind of give us a synopsis, and maybe even look for something interesting in the film that you wanted to take away?
When I set out to make The In-Between Place, I wanted to tell a personal story, one more personal than any of the others I had done. And so I went from that place and really just trying to make it as intimate as possible. So it really is like, it's a movie that wears its heart on its sleeve, and it's a little bit of me on the screen, more than other films in the past. This one is when you meet me and you look at that film, you can definitely see there's a good parallel there.
Awesome. Well, we're gonna take a look at that film, The In-Between Place, right here on The Real Deal.
The Mayans believe the kapok tree is sacred, that the souls of the people who have passed on climb all the way to the very tip top of the tree, and from there they can reach heaven. And the thorns, well, the thorns keep the demons at bay.
It's 11:29, and I am all alone. I've got a damaged view from a perfect window. All my frame's intact, but these eyes, they are cracked. I'm seeing double, and I don't know where you're at. These clouds hold so much rain, like reservoirs built in brain.
Yo, slacker boy.
Sorry.
I get the feeling that I scare you. I do. And so does she. You want to know a home truth I've gathered along the way? It's that I've spent a good part of my life afraid to go after the things that I deserve. And I see the same thing happening to you. We all know that you play music, and it's amazing. You're a genius. But you never play in front of people. You rarely talk, if you talk at all, and you can't even say hello to a girl that you've been fawning over for weeks now. What's stopping you?
I'm not really good at talking to people.
Everybody's good at talking about something. We just have to figure out what your something is. Have you ever been to the Ritz? My parents used to run this place when I was a kid. And then, just like everything else good in this town, it just existed. Time moving on. And it just sits and sits and sits. But it's still crazy beautiful.
This place is amazing.
And now I want you to go up on that stage and sing a song for me.
I've never.
What's stopping you? I want you to come anytime you need.
Thank you. Things can't go unsaid anymore. They just can't. And I know that you think this is all about you, but it's not. And the thing that you try to do to yourself. It nearly killed me.
When Mom died 2 years ago, we slipped into this place. This place without her. A place we'd never been before.
I feel like I live there still.
Too. We used to tell stories about Mom. Remember that? I love that. Dad, I loved that. It was like we were keeping her alive. Everybody's good at talking about something. And we just have to find what our something is. And I think we're good at talking about Mom.
She used to hit Josh from Seinfeld, remember that? And her laugh.
I always hated it when Mom would set me down and prepare me for when she died. Now I know why she did. She knew it was coming. She said, "Remember me. The beautiful, the ugly, everything in between." Now, all I can think is, how can I forget?
Miss, take them away. My heart's caged in shame. Trail away.
That was the in-between place from writer, director, and musician Jimmy Wilden. Let's talk a little bit about film racing. That film was part of a film race that you participated in.
Yes.
Could you tell me about your experience in film racing and what is the key to putting together a really good team?
So I started jumping into the film race environment in 2011. And what I've learned over the years is you really need to find a team where everyone's open to the collaboration. You may have a team leader or someone that's quote unquote in charge, but when everyone's on the same page, everything runs smoothly. If you have people who are fighting everything that you say, then it's all gonna fall apart. So for me, really sticking to a schedule and breaking it down and finding a team that really focuses on, you know, delivering the product rather than getting their own voice on the screen, you know, that's what it's about. When you're doing a race, it's not really about putting your voice on the screen. It's more about getting a completed project before the time is up.
So how do you do that? How are you communicating with your crew?
You set out from the very beginning, have meetings. And a lot of times what I've noticed is when you work with your friends, it's even better. So.
Oh, okay. So in these films that we watch, a lot of these crew and cast are friends of yours? So.
Over the years, yes. This last one, I had a couple friends, the in-between place, a couple of friends. And then actually that one, I worked with a lot of new filmmakers and new crew that I hadn't worked with before. So it kind of opened it up a little bit, but it was nice. It was nice.
What are the differences between working with like a regular film crew that doesn't have a deadline, such a tight deadline, because you're talking 24 hours, talking 48 hours, mm-hmm. sometimes, you know, 7 days. What's the difference between working on a regular film crew versus working on a film racing crew?
For me, it's not being able to get the takes that you want to get. Sometimes you have to let a little camera glitch go, or something that's slightly out of focus, you gotta just go with it because you don't have time and you have to start setting up for the next shot. You don't have the luxury of sitting there and going, okay, take one, all right, take 30, all right, take 40. You have to really, you know, set yourself with limits and get it done in 3 takes, 4 takes.
So there is some complacency involved. We can't go back, that'll take too much time and we won't mm-hmm. make it. Was there ever a moment for you where you're like, we're not gonna make it?
Every single time.
Yeah. Every single time?
Yeah, there's been years where it all just starts falling apart around you and you have to figure out a way to get through it. Other times where it's in editing and it's coming down to rendering out and the clock's already counting down and you're still waiting for it to render out on the computer. And it's like 10, 9, 8, and you finally get it and you hand it over.
So what do you suggest for filmmakers to do so they can avoid some of those delays? Have you developed some sort of plan of action?
Just go with the flow. Don't lose your hope, I guess. And, there's always going to be an obstacle when you're doing a film race. There's always going to be an obstacle, so you just have to fight it and go through it.
Let's talk about our next film that we're going to watch. We're going to watch mm-hmm. Howie. Again, give me a quick synopsis. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. There was a bed of music the entire time. So I feel that those roots of music are always there. But would you mind sharing with us what Howie is about? And again, if there's something there that we should take away.
So Howie is a film that was made for a 72-hour film race, and that one. I had a co-writer and director with me, Amadeus Rodriguez is his name, and his vision that he came up with originally was he wanted to do an H.P. Lovecraft kind of thing where you think that the story is going one way and then suddenly it evolves into something else completely. And so that's really where the roots of Howie came from. And I always saw the character as like a kind of spawn from the dude from The Big Lebowski, uh-huh. just a man-child that doesn't want to grow up.
And real quick, we're short on time. Why the name Howie?
Just popped in her head. I thought it was a good name.
Yeah, I kind of like it too. We're going to watch that right here on The Real Deal next. Howie from Jimmy Wilden.
¿Qué chingazos? ¿Todavía en el sofá? ¡Burro!
What are you doing?
Leave me alone.
I'm taking a break. Leave me alone.
I'm a nigga.
By shadows in the autumn leaves, we wore stolen hearts, vintage souls, aided by lies amongst the meeting of fools. And hey ho, where did it go? When
you'll never believe the morning I had today.
I could hear them yelling. One's like, "Oh, I'm sorry." No, and she had a phone. Then the phone through here. Like, no, she was like, "Yeah." So yeah, and I was like, "No, I'm scared to eat it."
That was the short film Howie from director Jimmy Wilden. I want to thank Jimmy for being here today and sharing his work with us. I want to thank you for supporting independent filmmaking and invite you back for another edition of The Real Deal. I'm Will Diaz, and that's a wrap.